So whenever you are factoring binomials, so binomial like two, it's important to start off with a basic observation. So if I have a plus b times a minus b, I can FOIL this out and get something, right? So I have a squared minus ab plus ab minus b squared. And hopefully, if I'm desperately observant, I can tell that these are going to cancel each other out, and I'm going to end up with a squared minus b squared. And so, therefore, we end up with this fabulous and useful little formula that a squared minus b squared is the same thing as a plus b times a minus b. So there are a ton of problems that you can do that are related to this, and it's all basically about pattern matching. So if I've got a problem like this, it's x squared minus 9, I can say, oh, check it out, it matches my formula where I have x squared minus 3 squared. So that means that I can factor that out as x plus 3 times x minus 3, because the 3 is what's squared, so that's what goes here and here. Got it? Kind of, sort of. And then pretty much this is all there is to it, is just recognizing the pattern and going for it. So if I said x squared minus 25, you'd say, okay, well, this is x squared, this is 5 squared, and I'm just adding the parentheses in case it helps you see it better. You don't have to put them in there for this particular problem. But I have x squared and then 5 squared, so that means it factors to x minus 5, x plus 5. Now, it's important to note that it doesn't matter if I say x plus 5, x minus 5, for the same reason that 3 times 2 is the same thing as 2 times 3. However, I can't say 5 minus x plus 5. Okay, I can't say this for the same reason that 3 minus 2 is not the same thing as 2 minus 3. Okay, so it does matter the order that you put the plus in, but it doesn't matter what order you put the actual factors in, because the factors are what you're multiplying together. When you're subtracting stuff, order very, very clearly matters. Whenever you see something like this, this is like the first level of trying to make it tricky. And in this case, they want you to go, okay, so I still have x squared, and well, what's 1? What's 1? What do I do here? And you say, oh, well, I know that 1 is actually 1 squared, so this actually still meets our pattern. So I have x plus 1 times x minus 1. Good? Fantastic? Woot. They can make these more interesting by making them look more complicated. So if I have x squared minus, say, 9y squared. Okay? So in a case like this, you're going to have to do a little bit more work and say, okay, so that's x squared minus something squared. That looks like something squared, and if you stare at it long enough, hopefully you can come up with the idea that this is 3y, the whole thing squared, right? Because if I have 3y squared, I know that that squared applies to each term inside, like that. Okay? So hopefully this way you can make the connection that that's 3y squared. So it's going to be x plus 3y and x minus 3y. And again, if you ever freak out or you're ever wondering, doubting yourself, whatever, you can always FOIL it and get a check on your answer. Cancel, cancel. So you checked it out and it worked. Okay? So you're not without recourse if you get stuck on something. So let's see. What else can we do? We can put the more complicated looking term in the front, something like this. So I recommend that as you're watching these videos to like pause me and like go try to do these problems independently if you want to. It's a really good way to make sure you actually understand what's going on, because it's one thing to say, yeah, I get it if you're saying it, but if you make me do it on my own, I'm like, ah, my brain hurts. So you just got to figure out what you need to put in here. Now this one's just a one, but over here, let's see, if I have 2x, the quantity squared, that's going to get me 4x squared. So again, I'll have 2x minus 1 and 2x plus 1. Let's see, what else can we do to these? Ooh, let's do both. Like this. Again, try to go do this on your own. Pause the video, try to work it out, come back, see if you got it right. See if you can match the pattern. 5A, 3B. 5A plus 3B. And 5A minus 3B. Okay. Now, what if we gave you something a little bit more complicated looking? Fractions always look scary. So let's try fraction. And then you go, I can't do that. That's just silly. It's actually not silly. Well, it's silly, but that doesn't mean you can't do it. What squared gives you 1/4? And this might give you pause. If you say 1/8, I understand why you're saying that, but you need to go backwards. It's not 1/8. It's actually 1/2. If you're trying to remember why, remember 1/2 is the same. Squared is the same thing as 1/2 times 1/2. 1 times 1 is 1. 2 times 2 is 4. So 1/2 squared is actually 1/4. So then I can just plug them on in here. Y minus 1/2. Y plus 1/2. Like that. All kinds of exciting. So similarly, if you had something like x squared minus 4/9, something like that. Again, pause this video so you can come up with it. See if you can find the pattern. X squared minus, what number goes in here? 2/3. So I can say x plus 2/3, x minus 2/3. We can make these more interesting by giving you interesting looking powers. Does it sound like you can break through glass with your face or something? Would that be a power? I'm not sure. So basically, is like what squared minus what squared? And this is where your exponent laws come into play. So here in the first term, I would say, well, x squared squared is x to the 4th. Y cubed squared is y to the 6th. So whenever I'm plugging these in, it's going to be x squared plus y cubed and x squared minus y cubed, like that. Okay. Something to note is that if you have something like x squared plus 4, so just the simple act of changing that plus to a minus means that we can't factor this without imaginary numbers. So we're not going to factor this out. Okay? So just because there's a plus sign, that doesn't mean, oh, I can do it, I'm just going to reverse the sign somehow. If that plus sign is there, then there's no dice. You're game over. Game over. So sad. About the only other thing they can do to liven these up a little bit is to throw in something interesting. Say, for example, 4x cubed minus 49x. In a problem like this, first of all, they want you to recognize, oh, I need to pull an x out. Okay, now if I pull an x out, who's left? Okay, if I pull an x out, who's left? Okay. Oh, okay, so see, now I've still got the difference of two squares. So I've got a 2x goes in here and a 7 goes in there. So that means that that original thing is equal to 2x plus 7 and 2x minus 7. Make sense? As another example, they could give you something like, I think I'm doing this right, 98x to the 4th minus 2. So what would you do with that? So in this problem, instead of factoring out an x, let's factor out a 2. If we factor a 2 out of there, we should get 49x squared minus 1. Now it's up to you to recognize that, you know, hey, this is actually a difference of squares. And figure out what to do with that. So this in here is going to be 7x, and this one here is going to be 1. So 2, 7x minus 1. 7x plus 1. All kinds of exciting, huh? One more, just for grins, I suppose. Let's say negative 25x squared plus 81. Now, a problem like this, you might be initially tempted attempted, might be initially tempted to factor out a negative 1 and do some stuff in here, I would say that that's not the best way to solve this problem because there's a faster way. And the faster way to solve this is to simply switch the order. Because since we're adding them together, this is a completely legitimate step. So if you take this step, it's pretty straightforward to say 5x like that. And then now I see I have a difference between two squares. 9 minus 5x and 9 plus 5x.